Hodder and Stoughton Audio presents 2020, World of War, by Paul Cornish and Kingsley Donaldson. Read for you by Jonathan Keeble. Author's note and acknowledgements. We who have put this book together know very well that the only forecast that can be made with any confidence of the course and outcome of another world war, should there be one, is that nothing will happen exactly as we have shown here. These are the words with which General Sir John Hackett and his co-authors concluded the Third World War, August 1985, A Future History. Having set out to write an adaptation of Hackett's imaginative and provocative book, one more suited to the security challenges of the present day, we have all along sought to emulate Hackett's caution regarding strategic prediction and overconfident futurology. If events could turn out as described here, then that is reason enough to ask whether that possibility has been contemplated seriously, and whether preparations have been made. Where security, defence, and national strategy are concerned, what is not acceptable is to abandon thought, analysis, and preparation until the future reveals itself. Where we differ from Hackett's approach is that we do not contemplate the possibility of another world war, or any other form of global cataclysm. Instead, 2020 World of War depicts 21st century international security as a complex of interwoven pressures, challenges, hazards, and threats. In the course of this project, we have drawn upon countless conversations, discussions, seminars, and conferences in the UK, Europe, the United States, and elsewhere around the world. Our friends and colleagues in government, the armed forces, research institutes, universities, and the media are all owed our thanks. These discussions inform the selection of topics and scenarios that form the core of this book. 2020, World of War, was conceived and delivered as a collaborative effort, and these scenarios could not have been written without expert contributions from the following. Professor Kerry Brown, Professor of Chinese Studies and Director of the Lao China Institute, King's College, London. Associate Fellow, Chatham House, London. Mr. Anthony Cornish, author and editor, Longmead Publishing. Professor Christopher Donnelly, CMG, Director, Institute for Statecraft, London. Professor Julian Lindley French, Vice President of the Atlantic Treaty Association, Distinguished Visiting Research Fellow of the National Defense University in Washington, D.C., and a Fellow of the Canadian Global Affairs Institute. Dr. Rajiv Nayan, Senior Research Associate, Institute for Defense Studies and Analyses, Delhi. Ms. Prabha Rao, Senior Fellow, Institute for Defense Studies and Analyses, Delhi. Mr. Nathan Ryan, Defense and Security Analyst, RAND Europe, Cambridge. Dr. Uttam Kumar Sinha, Fellow, Institute for Defense Studies and Analyses, Delhi. Distinguished Fellow, Institute for National Security Studies, Sri Lanka. Professor Gareth Stansfield, Al-Kazimi Chair of Arab Gulf Studies and Professor of Middle East Politics, University of Exeter. Following the example set by Hackett and his fellow authors, no contributions to 2020 World of War are signed, since strict attribution would not be easy in so cooperative an enterprise. Our final word of thanks must go to Rupert Lancaster, our publisher at Hodder and Stoughton, and to Barry Johnston for his meticulous and patient editorial guidance. Paul Cornish and Kingsley Donaldson, March 2017. Introduction. Our world rapidly worsens. Nothing now is so horrid or silly it can't occur. W. H. Auden, 1972. Cold War Strategy. With the Cold War at its height, 1978 saw the publication of The Third World War, August 1985, A Future History, by General Sir John Hackett and others. The Third World War was a work of fiction, centred upon a scenario in which the armed forces of the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact launched a major offensive into NATO's central region, crossing the inner German border separating the Federal Republic of Germany, West Germany, from its estranged close relative, the German Democratic Republic, East Germany. The uneasy stability of the Cold War collapsed into full-scale conflict, as both sides committed their land, air, and maritime forces to the struggle for Europe. Sir John Hackett was a highly decorated veteran of the Second World War, who had fought in the Syria-Lebanon campaign and in North Africa, where he was awarded the Distinguished Service Order. Having begun his career as an armoured soldier, Hackett was only 33 when he commanded the 4th Parachute Brigade in Operation Market Garden, the unsuccessful attempt in September 1944 to capture vitally important bridges across the Maas and the Rhine. Badly injured in the operation, Hackett was awarded a second DSO for his service at Arnhem. After the war, Hackett rose to command both the British Army of the Rhine and NATO's Northern Army Group, before retiring from the British Army in the late 1960s. Hackett was subsequently to become the epitome of the modern soldier scholar. A graduate of Oxford University, he was fluent in many languages and a noted author and lecturer in military history and strategic analysis. He concluded his academic career as principal of King's College London from 1968 to 1975. Known for the sharpness of his intellect as much as his physical courage, Hackett was a man of trenchant opinions concerning national strategy and defence. In 1968, while controversially still a very senior serving officer, Hackett wrote a letter to the Times newspaper in which he criticised the government's complacency over the capabilities of NATO forces in Europe. Hackett's critical edge was to re-emerge in 1978 in the form of the Third World War. This was future history, driven by a very straightforward idea. It was one scenario developing along a singular path to one conclusion, including the end of Birmingham, the UK's second largest city, in a nuclear strike. This linearity was characteristic of Cold War strategic thinking at the time. The Cold War had begun in the late 1940s, and for the following 30 years or so, there had been no shortage of hot war around the world. But none of these conflicts captured the Cold War strategic imagination, of which the core concern was the outbreak of war along the European Central Front, as it was known throughout the middle decades of the 20th century, leading to the use of nuclear weapons between East and West. The Third World War captured both the public imagination and that of Cold War politico-military experts. The book achieved popular and critical success in the United Kingdom, and it was serialized in several newspapers in the United States. The success of the Third World War was attributable in part to Hackett's reputation and in part to the convictions underpinning Cold War strategic thinking. The book also drew heavily upon the perceived certainties of recent history, conveying as it did that at some point international insecurity would probably lead to major war, the conduct of which would probably be fought, initially at least, along the lines of the Second World War in Europe. In that vein, the Third World War reflected growing disquiet that Cold War strategic certainty was not being matched by military readiness. National strategy for the 21st century. To a considerable extent, national security policymakers and defence strategists are concerned with the passage of time, past, present, and future. A national strategic outlook is rooted in a political, cultural, and geostrategic past, perhaps several centuries old. The more recent past offers a bank of military, intelligence, and other experiences connecting to the deeper historical context and providing much-needed lessons in the application of national power, both successes and failures. One of those lessons is that even the most compelling analysis and the most reasonable scenarios can prove to be inaccurate. The Third World War did not begin in August 1985. By then, Mikhail Gorbachev had been General Secretary of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union for 5 months. Gorbachev's coming to power instead signaled the beginning of the end of the Cold War, in a manner very different from that imagined by Hackett and his fellow authors. With the benefit of hindsight, the immediate post-Cold War period was also the point at which national strategy and defence began to decline, both in substance and in relative political significance. During the 1990s, governments across Europe grasped the opportunity to make major savings in defence expenditure, in both manpower and equipment, using such expressions as New World Order and Peace Dividend to validate their decisions. After all, no serious case could be made for NATO members to retain large numbers of well-equipped troops in order to fight the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact, both now defunct. Yet while it must draw lessons from the recent past, national strategy must be concerned primarily with the present and the future, with articulating a view of the world, its strategic challenges and opportunities, and with organizing national resources so as to achieve the optimal balance of capabilities, diplomatic, policing, development, aid, military, trade, intelligence, cultural outreach, and so on. The obvious difficulty is that the future is by definition unknowable, and therefore unpredictable. The Economist, J.K. Galbraith, reportedly divided forecasters between those who know they don't know, and those who don't know they don't know. An aphorism which at least makes it possible to distinguish between those so-called futures analysts, who have wisdom in their ignorance, and those who do not. But the most that can be said of Galbraith's words is that they describe the problem of the future without offering a solution to it. For those concerned with national security and defence strategy, the problem of the future is that it's not only vast and protean, but also inescapable. The most complex of problems to which a solution must nevertheless be sought, and to which scarce resources must nevertheless be committed. When national strategists look to the future, they might be excused for finding it a rather bleak prospect, a dystopian world of competition, contest, and conflict, in which security and stability will be challenged in every conceivable way, economic, environmental, technological, criminal, and ideological, and on every conceivable level, global, interstate, intrastate, commercial, and individual. This analysis could result in an exaggerated sense of crisis, if not impending apocalypse, crowding out the likelihood that the future will also offer plentiful opportunities for peace and prosperity around the world. But a pessimistic view of the future might also be accurate, and it's that possibility which cannot be overlooked, least of all by strategic decision-makers and military planners. While national strategy is concerned with the future, including the worst of futures, it is also characterized by process and expenditure. National strategy requires assessment, decision, planning, purchase, and implementation, all of which demand a protracted engagement with the future in all its uncertainty. Development aid, for example, if it is to result in sustainable improvements, might involve investment and assistance plans spanning a generation or more. Taking a similarly long view, effective intelligence gathering might require new technologies to be devised and deployed, information networks to be cultivated, and officers to be trained to high levels of proficiency in certain languages. And unless armed forces are to be given unlimited resources to undertake any sort of operation anywhere in the world, they too must engage with the future. They must train for certain types of operations in certain regions, using equipment that might have taken as much as a decade to design and acquire. If national strategy is expected to be informed by the past, to manage the present, and to be responsive to the future, and if that future could be as complex, intractable, and dangerous as suggested above, then it's at least possible that strategic decision-makers and planners might revert to their comfort zone and concentrate on what they know best, the past and the present. Yet to do so would be to succumb to the most non-strategic form of confirmation bias. Since we do not know the future, we will assume the future to be what we know. How then can national strategy, and particularly military leaders, analysts and planners, remain engaged with a future that they cannot know, and make expensive preparations for contingencies that they cannot predict? The international security picture of the 21st century is far from linear and straightforward. There is no singular, predictable, adversarial relationship, as there was during the Cold War. Governments around the world now face a more challenging combination of diversity, complexity, and urgency. Current trends suggest that the international security future will be neither black nor white. The UK and its allies might not be at war, strictly speaking, but they might not be at peace either. Security threats might not be existential, but neither will they be trivial. it would be difficult to set priorities among a wide range of security challenges, both natural hazards and man-made threats. 21st century international security is likely to involve security threats and challenges that are largely unpredictable in their source, timing, and consequences. And it will be difficult to discriminate between short and long-term challenges to security and well-being. National strategy must nevertheless be prepared to confront these multiple challenges to security. Challenges may or may not reinforce each other, whether unintentionally or as the result of deliberate collaboration, or as the result of unintended consequences in our own planning and reaction. For example, the crisis in Syria, where military operations have precipitated huge population displacement, which has in turn contributed to the migration crisis currently being experienced in Europe. The response to this complexity has so far been disappointing. With some rare exceptions, investment in broad-spectrum research and deep analysis of global security trends has become unfashionable, or at best repetitive. Wikipedia, Google, and online crowdsourced intelligence, something of a misnomer, are now considered authoritative and definitive sources through which many senior decision-makers are being given their information, ideally in the form of a two-page briefing note with accompanying lines to take for use at press conferences. The wide availability of very shallow knowledge has led to the illusion of profound understanding. Certainly more is known about the contemporary world than could be said for any previous generation, but our critical understanding and strategic wisdom are arguably much weaker than those of our forebears. They may not have had access to 24-hour news from across the globe, but that which they knew, they understood. 2020, World of War. While the attitudes of politicians to defence spending reductions might not have changed much in the 40 or so years since Hackett published The Third World War, the world has changed dramatically in that time. In order to gauge the depth and breadth of this change, 2020, World of War, takes a fundamentally different, much less linear approach to contemporary challenges in international security. Our first chapter examines the strategic challenge posed by Russia, and asks how Hackett and his co-authors might interpret Russia's capabilities and intentions, were they alive today and contributing to the policy debate. The second chapter shows that in the early to mid-21st century, security policy and defence strategy must take account of a breadth of non-traditional, non-military dynamics, such as climate change, resource scarcity, and health security, all of which Hackett et al. Might have considered peripheral or exotic, or both. We then discuss the international security environment in terms of various scenarios. The first three scenarios take a broadly geopolitical approach to security in Southeast Asia, South Asia, and the Middle East, respectively. These are followed by two thematic scenarios, the first dealing with crime and terrorism, and the second with cybersecurity, before we turn to UK domestic security. Our final omni-scenario makes the essential point that international security challenges might very well not behave themselves and arrive one at a time at our convenience. It's important to understand that our scenarios are illustrative. They have been designed in order to underpin the central argument of this book. That argument runs as follows. Instead of waiting patiently for some new, large-scale and largely military equivalent of Cold War strategic certainty to reveal itself, national strategists must instead engage with international security as it is, in all its diversity, complexity, and uncertainty. Used in this way, scenarios are simply an analytical device. They are not attempts at prediction, and least of all do they seek to exaggerate or inflame situations, or give offence to any government, people, or organisation depicted. There will, nevertheless, be those critics for whom 2020 World of War is worst-case analysis or even scaremongering. We would reject the latter criticism, but welcome the former. This book is knowingly and deliberately an exercise in worst-case analysis, and as such it is arguably precisely how security and defence policymakers and analysts should be spending much of their time in a chaotic and often confusing world. Given the complexity and diversity of the international security outlook, it's only through well-reasoned scenario-based analysis that strategic risk can be properly and periodically quantified and managed. This is never more important than when decisions are being taken not to act in a particular instance. Gaining an insight through scenario-based analysis into both the intended and unintended consequences of deliberate choices to intervene or desist is crucial in making assured strategic decisions. The scenarios are also bounded in time. 2020 World of War deliberately takes a very short-term view of the international security landscape in order to accentuate the volatility with which national strategy must engage. In this regard, the book provides a counterpoint to the 10-year no-war rule adopted by the United Kingdom in the 1920s and 1930s, and its 5+5 variant adopted in the 1940s. In a sense, the rule, in either variant, amounted to a willing suspension of strategic judgment. In all three decades, the rule was arguably a reasonable response, not least in times of austerity, to a linear threat projection. Germany in the first instance, the Soviet Union in the second, which seemed to suggest that a strategic holiday could be taken, at least for some years. Conversely, we argue that this is the least appropriate moment to resort to a strategic, psychological comfort blanket of this sort, to suspend strategic judgment while adversaries' intentions and capabilities are allowed to clarify. Strategic threats and challenges are no longer of one type, such as largely military, and in the UK and elsewhere, a national strategic outlook can no longer be narrow and linear. Each of the chosen scenarios is sufficiently plausible and credible, and sufficiently complex to provoke serious strategic consideration. Taken together, they convey the sense of a strategically chaotic future. Although chaotic, 2020 World of War stops short of presenting an image of international strategic pandemonium. To do so would be alarmist, passive, and ultimately self-defeating, describing a strategic future for which nothing can be planned, no preparation can be made, and no action can be undertaken. To reiterate, these are scenarios, but they are not predictions. They are not required to be true, although they must be authentic, and their purpose is simply to provoke thought and analysis, and a little humility. Whereas Hackett and his co-authors used what they considered to be the strategic certainties of the Cold War to warn against the lack of military preparedness, 2020 World of War conveys an image of global strategic uncertainty, even chaos, and warns against a lack of general strategic engagement, of which military preparation is only one part. The scenarios presented in this book are not intended to be taken literally, in quite the same way as Hackett's future history. But if these scenarios and the concerns that underpin them are not at least taken seriously, this will be the result of strategic complacency, more damaging even than that feared by Hackett. Simply because nothing on the scale of the Cold War seems currently imminent is no reason to lose interest in and commitment to strategic analysis. As the popular aphorism goes, the absence of evidence is not the evidence of absence. In matters of international security and national strategy, the argument from ignorance is surely the least satisfactory of all. Chapter 1. From Cold War to Hot Peace. The Russian Strategic Challenge. Introduction. How would Hackett and the co-authors of the Third World War interpret Russian behaviour today? And, more to the point, what response would they recommend? Hackett's aim in publishing his seminal book was simple enough. He knew how terrible war was, and he did not want to see another happen unnecessarily or by miscalculation. As a way to manage adversarial international relations, Hackett understood that deterrence was preferable to war. But he also understood that deterrence does not obviate military preparedness. Far from it. Deterrence requires military strength if it is to succeed, and it cannot be allowed to mask military weakness. Hackett also saw that nuclear deterrence needed a strong conventional military force to give it credibility, to create an escalatory ramp so as to provide an opportunity for reflection in event of hostilities, and to prevent war by miscalculation or accident. He could see with great clarity that, more than anything, deterrence depended on a demonstration of unflinching political will. It was a combination of both having the tools and demonstrating the will to use them that did the job. He wrote his book because he saw that, in the Britain of his day, both will and tools were failing. If there is such a thing, the national mood in Britain during the 1970s was far from buoyant. A very unpleasant and costly civil conflict had begun in Northern Ireland. National morale and self-confidence were very low following a series of crippling strikes that had led to the introduction of a 3-day working week, a very destructive political crisis, and staggering inflation. A change of government did nothing to improve the situation, until at the end of the decade, the winter of discontent and a new election brought Margaret Thatcher to power. The cost of health, education, and social security, which until the mid-1970s had together consumed about a third of government spending, began to rise, and the maintenance of the UK's conventional defence forces, principally in Germany, was progressively neglected. The British Army was focusing on fighting the Northern Ireland campaign. Strategic and operational thinking about how to fight and win in Germany against a peer enemy was virtually abandoned. The feeling was of a Britain in hopeless, perhaps terminal decline. It was against that backdrop that Hackett delivered his warning. Superpower confrontation collapsed at the end of the Cold War, with the demise of the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact. At that point, the Western model, which rejected armed force as an acceptable tool for resolving disputes between European and, by association, all nations, was deemed to have triumphed, and, it was assumed, would become universal. The supposed triumph of liberal democracy was the basis of Francis Fukuyama's celebrated book, The End of History and the Last Man, published in 1992. But things have turned out otherwise. Britain today is not suffering as it was in the 1970s. Despite the impact of the credit crunch and economic downturn of 2008 to 2009, there is a high degree of political stability and economic prosperity. Yet the impact of rapid and profound global change has been to trigger widespread crises of governance across the world, including in the advanced democracies. Across Europe, established political systems are experiencing a crisis in public confidence, resulting in the rise of anti-establishment figures, parties and movements, as evinced in extreme right-wing movements gaining popularity in the Scottish referendum and in the UK Brexit referendum in June 2016, and the US presidential election later the same year. However serious the impact on established, prosperous democracies, the effects of this global change are far more acute in countries with ineffectual, brittle governments, for whatever reason, tradition, ideology, corruption, technical or political incompetence, or a combination of these, that lack responsiveness to their people's aspirations. The result can be sudden governmental collapse, as in the Arab Spring, Eastern Europe's colour revolutions, or Ukraine's 2014 Maidan. The threat of such developments can be used as a justification for strong dictatorial rule to protect a national leadership from destabilization. Using language with which Hackett and his fellow authors would have been familiar, this has been the reaction of the Russian leadership, which has chosen to interpret the three examples listed above as deliberate Western plots, the ultimate target of which, the Russians presume, to be the Kremlin itself. Understanding the Russian strategic challenge. Following the collapse of the USSR, traditional ideas of large-scale industrial warfare no longer provided the most convincing explanation for conflict involving major powers. The reason was simple: US technological predominance, which made it futile to challenge the West in areas where it was strongest. Those countries and organizations which, for one reason or another, did not see fit to accept the Western economic, diplomatic, and strategic preferences and wished to challenge Western global dominance had to search for alternatives to classic war if they were to have any hope of success in their challenge. The result is that what Hackett would have understood as the 19th and 20th century model of conflict as being between two clear belligerents, countries, alliances, ideologies, has been replaced today with a system, if it can be called that, which is far more fractured and often confused. Violent conflict now seems to be an option for a multiplicity of actors, organizations, and even small groups, each pursuing their own goals on their own terms. In that respect, the world might even be said to be reverting to type. A war of all against all, as the English philosopher Thomas Hobbes put it, in which violent conflict is the norm rather than the exception. In this more complex global system, where all significant players, countries, corporations, or sub-state groups such as Al-Qaeda, Islamic State, and Hamas, are competing simultaneously against each other, as well as against the environment in which they are operating, the resulting hyper-competition is the underlying basic element in the new paradigm of conflict. Many in the West had come to see theirs as the only world model after the competing Soviet system failed in 1990. However, the failed wars and financial crisis of recent years have undermined the credibility of the Western model in the eyes of much of the world. This has given credibility, and even in some eyes, respectability to those who, for various reasons, now wish to challenge the Western liberal international order and establish their own version as an alternative, or even as the dominant model. China and Russia both challenge the West's predominance in this way, as of course do Islamic State and similar groups. The challenge to the West is fundamental and certainly requires a coordinated strategic response. But how good is the West at adapting and responding to a strategic challenge on this scale? In crude terms, liberal democracies equip themselves best for the environment they prefer and can be reluctant to invest in and prepare for adverse conditions. In time of peace and stability, the tendency of liberal democracies is to select leaders, politicians, corporate CEOs and boards, and even senior military officers, who will do best in a peaceful, stable environment. In 1939, for example, of the British battalion and divisional commanders who were in command of their units and formations when the UK joined the war on the 3rd of September, only a small number were still in command 6 months later. This was because the skills, abilities, attitude, mentality, and behaviour needed from the peacetime military leader proved to be radically different from those required in wartime. When the war ended, conversely, many officers who had experienced outstanding military careers could not cope with peacetime conditions and became ineffectual misfits whose post-war civilian careers failed because their wartime skills did not suit peacetime conditions. Hackett was a notable exception. In a period of rapid and possibly profound strategic turbulence, the requirement is for leaders who have the abilities to meet the challenge for what it is, not for what they might prefer it to be. Liberal democracies are not at war, at least not in the sense of the Second World War, but neither can they be said to be enjoying a period of stable peace. In these circumstances, the requirement is neither for wartime nor for peacetime leaders. What is needed are strategic leaders. Vladimir Putin is a good example of a leader with a strategic mentality, in marked contrast to most of his current Western counterparts. With his KGB background and exposure to the corrupting influence of money in East Germany, combined with his cleverness, ruthlessness, and ambition, he rose to the top during the turmoil, vicious free-for-all, and extreme violence that characterized Russia in the 1990s. This process of natural selection rewarded Putin's competitive mentality. His ability to deal with complexity, instability, and uncertainty, his readiness to deploy violence where necessary to achieve his aims, his capacity to think and act strategically, exploiting and creating opportunities. Putin's ability to achieve his policy objectives in today's turbulent international system differs notably from that of many Western leaders, as does his willingness to use all forms of power in pursuit of his aims. Putin needs a zero-sum competitive environment if he is to thrive. He has not hesitated to create such an environment when it suits him. To understand Putin's position, It's necessary to return to Russia in the mid-1980s. Gorbachev came to power when the USSR was failing economically, unable to match the West. Massive investment in military power had not only failed to give a return on investment, it had contributed significantly to the economic disaster. No longer could the state control the flow of external information to its population, as had been the case in the past. The Moscow Olympics, arguably, had done much to open the information floodgates. The election of a highly popular Polish pope had triggered nationalist movements in the Eastern European satellite countries. Terrible social and public health conditions afflicted the USSR, and nationality problems gripped many of its constituent republics. The ruling Communist Party everywhere suffered a precipitous decline in public trust and confidence. Gorbachev's answer was reform, liberalization of the economy, diffusing the tension with the West, drastic reductions in military spending, moving away from confrontation, opening society to Western ideas, relaxing power over Warsaw Pact allies, and loosening strict Communist Party control. The result was catastrophic for the Soviet system. The USSR disintegrated, 250 million people losing not only their country and their ideology in the turmoil, but also their pensions. In the tumultuous decade that followed for Russia, extreme instability, societal violence, and jungle capitalism destroyed the reputation of democracy as a political answer. Vladimir Putin came to power during that same decade. It should be scarcely surprising, therefore, that he has described the collapse of the Soviet Union as the greatest catastrophe of the 20th century. After some years attempting to rebuild Russia's position in the world, Putin found himself leading a Russia once again with a failing economy, unable to match the West and China, and with desperate social problems and growing national minority issues that drastically affected his own popularity and popular faith in his leadership. What was his response to be? To follow Gorbachev's discredited model of reform? Or to adapt and compete? It should be no surprise that Putin chose his own, not Gorbachev's path, rejecting the Western blueprint, reversing Russia's decline, and presenting Russia as a proud, strong, and even moral alternative on a path to confrontation with the West. He is not the first ruler to restore his waning popularity by creating adversaries and provoking grievance and conflict. But what is especially notable is the way Putin has gone about it, creating a form of strategic competition that is neither peace nor war, but somewhere in between. The emergence of ambiguous or hybrid warfare. There is no standard vocabulary with agreed definitions to describe Russia's evolving strategic posture. Simply importing the language of traditional kinetic, industrial, and high technology warfare can have misleading results. Different Western authors use different terms, and Russian writers use different terms again. Most commonly, nelinearная война, non-linear warfare. In much of the West's political and military leadership, the new and elaborate strategic outlook developed under Putin's leadership is known as hybrid warfare. Whatever vocabulary is used, the core principle of this form of strategic competition and conflict is that it can and does turn everything into a weapon. Hybrid warfare could encompass some or even all of the following sectors and practices at different moments and at different levels of intensity: cybercrime, espionage, intrusion, and possibly electoral manipulation. Disruption of energy supplies. Preference given to Russian popular culture and language. Appeal to the authority of religion, ideals, and ideology. Economic measures and countermeasures. Manipulative financial investments. Financial crime, including bribes, corruption. Serious and organized crime. State-approved business practices. Political assassination. Traditional Cold War-style subversion and espionage. Strategic communications, information, influence, and lobbying. Psychological operations and deception. It would be wrong, however, to see these necessarily as alternatives to the use of classic kinetic military force. Ambiguous, or hybrid, warfare combines the tools and methods of hyper-competition described earlier with the use of military force in its many forms, including plausibly deniable military force, such as proxies, supposedly civilian contractors, ostensibly civil militias, as well as the Little Green Men and troops in disguise, which were deployed by Russia in Ukraine in recent years. The classic use of conventional forces, land, air, sea, and space. The threat to use nuclear weapons. The Ukraine crisis saw Russia experimenting with the various tools at its disposal and learning accordingly. In many ways, Ukraine exemplifies the strategic challenge to the West, in which the hybrid warfare weapons listed above were combined with a more traditional use of lethal military technology. It would be a mistake to assume that this challenge is limited in time or space. Russia has been using the weapons of hyper-competition against the West for years. It's a general strategic challenge, rather than a challenge over the future of Ukraine, serious though that challenge undoubtedly is. But because this is only poorly understood in Western capitals, European governments today consistently underestimate the effort Russia has been putting into its strategic challenge through influence, information, and other non-kinetic weapons or tools listed above. In Eastern Europe, by contrast, both the nature and the gravity of Russia's strategic challenge are much better understood. The Prussian general, Karl von Clausewitz, once observed, "The aggressor is always peace-loving. He would prefer to take over our country unopposed. To prevent his doing this, we must be both willing and prepared to make war." In modern terms, preparing to make war means war using all the forms of power available, including kinetic means. To try to define these simply as hard and soft power is really not adequate, and can even mislead. There is nothing soft about any of these powers when used as a weapon, least of all information. The information weapon is now coming to be acknowledged as a problem by some Western governments. Ironically, in concentrating on understanding Russia's use of information as a weapon or tool of hyper-competition, and rather belatedly at that, we have tended to play down the corresponding growing relevance of classic military power in Europe. The political imperative in many Western countries for the last quarter of a century has been to cut defence spending. In the UK, government spending on health, social security, and education together now consumes not one-third, but over two-thirds of government spending, leaving only one-third for everything else, defence included. It has thus become difficult, if not embarrassing, for politicians to acknowledge that classic kinetic warfare is still important, even if its relative utility has changed. New forms of power have not rendered conventional military force obsolete. Indeed, in some parts of the world, such as in the Indian subcontinent, it still retains much of its 20th century significance. In Europe, it is a key and increasingly significant element in Russia's overall strategic outlook. Yet within the British Army, for example, the exhausting effects of more than two decades of intense operational commitments, coupled with stringent cuts in the defence budget and the impact of defence cost inflation, have meant that commanders have ceased to think seriously about how to defeat a peer enemy. The UK, arguably, no longer has the equipment needed to do so, nor the industry and acquisition systems necessary to create that equipment quickly and at the necessary scale. Some analysts claim that with a fleet of just 19 frigates and destroyers, the Royal Navy is today below the critical mass needed to survive, let alone expand quickly and regenerate. Similar things are said of the British Army and the Royal Air Force. Advocates for increased defence spending in the UK face a hard struggle in political circles. It's as though the national mechanisms for strategic thinking, decision, and preparation have been lost, with some in government even questioning the need for a national strategy. It is this situation that makes the warning given in the Third World War so relevant today. And this is despite the obvious differences in weaponry, the growth of hybrid warfare, and the complexities of the international situation that make it so difficult to be confident of future security trends and forthcoming threats. Neither is it solely the UK that is affected. All European countries have reduced their forces, and defence cost inflation has cut their size even further, making equipment and manpower unaffordable on a large scale. European societies have shown themselves to be ever more unwilling to suffer losses in lives, finance, and lifestyle, and international institutions, such as NATO, have been overtaken by events, becoming ineffectual and in urgent need of reform and rejuvenation. For NATO, having spent almost all of the 21st century campaigning against a third world enemy, calls to confront the Russian strategic challenge are inconvenient and awkward. When reality proves too difficult to manage, it can be tempting to indulge in some modish displacement activity, such as the deployment of battlegroups here and there, or the construction of new headquarters, none of which are in any way adequate to meet or mitigate the Russian threat. Yet the task faced by Western governments is clear enough: to rediscover how to employ traditional coercive military force, albeit available now on a much smaller scale, as part of our own ability to fight hybrid warfare, and to prevail. This includes the revival of an adversary-agnostic, comprehensive and credible deterrence posture, ranging from low-level to high-level, including conventional as well as nuclear forces, involving all levers of government power and influence, diplomatic, economic and cultural, and able to meet all levels and types of threat. But with conventional armed forces having been so much reduced since the end of the Cold War, Western deterrence is in danger of lacking continuity and therefore credibility, a challenge for NATO. From the Kremlin's perspective, the weakness of the West's military response to Russian aggression in Ukraine presented an opportunity to step up their strategic challenge. This brought the Russian military more into the frame in Syria, where the West's response has been weak and incoherent. Strategically, it could be said that while Western governments might claim the moral high ground in these and other situations, Russia maintains the initiative. The difference that hybrid warfare makes. Like any other form of conflict and warfare, hyper-competition and hybrid warfare have evolved from earlier concepts and are continuing to evolve. As they involve the use of all forms of power, they do not sit naturally within any single government department. Yet for maximum effect, these many forms of power must be used coherently. To do this, to be able to generate, deploy, and employ all these forms of power effectively, it's essential to be able to think and act strategically across all departments of government. In recent years, and in common with many other European countries, the UK's capability for national strategy making has atrophied. Many politicians today have gone so far as to oppose the idea of a national, or as some prefer, grand strategy. Often, it seems, for reasons of party political expediency. To restore this capability for strategy, the UK and Western governments in general will need to take a number of steps. Recognise the nature of today's strategic contest. Have a clear understanding of national and allied interests and objectives. Create new mechanisms for focused and rapid strategy making. Educate and promote strategic thinkers. Create an appropriate command system for implementation of strategy. Ensure popular understanding of and support for the strategy adopted. Only strategy, in its fullest politico-military sense, will enable Western governments to manage the complexity and dynamism of the 21st century international ecosystem in which they find themselves. It's only strategy that makes it possible to understand and engage with the fact that allies in one area might be competitors in another. Russia's ability to work with China is a good example of two countries that, although not natural friends, are able to put strategy into practice, building collaboration where mutual interest coincides. It's clear from the Third World War that Hackett thoroughly understood strategy, and that when dealing with Russia, To compartmentalize a problem such as Ukraine and to look for solutions specific to that problem will only result in being outmaneuvered strategically. In early 2017, Russia has many ways in which it can counter Western moves. By taking action in the Arctic, a crucial region in current Russian strategic thinking. Through restricting its supply of energy to Western countries. By taking advantage of the situation with migrants. By making it difficult to achieve a durable solution in Syria or with Iran. By withdrawing financial investments from national capitals. Or in a variety of other ways. Even by creating anti-Western feeling in Latin America, where RT, formerly Russia Today, is already the most widely watched and trusted foreign media outlet. The implications for the future design of Western armed forces are considerable. Even if governments increase defence spending, it will never be possible to hold permanently within our armed forces all the people and skills necessary to wage hybrid warfare, using all the forms of power now available. Even if all NATO defence budgets met the target of 2% of GDP, it would not be possible to defeat all the conceivable military and other threats that might arise. The issue of defence spending across Europe, usually discussed in terms of the arbitrary 2% target to which NATO member states have agreed, is symptomatic of the structural bias towards peace and stability within liberal democracies, even in the face of evidence to the contrary. There has thus been no serious, authoritative assessment of the optimum level of investment in national defence that a state should make for greatest effect, whether it's 2% of GDP or more, or less. But if historical example is anything to go by, states that really fear for their security have generally been prepared to spend much more than that to ensure it. In this way, discussion returns to the problem of governments being unwilling or unable to recognise that they are facing a strategic challenge. To deal with this challenge, armed forces should evolve to be genuinely and effectively adaptable. That means understanding what constitutes a critical mass for each function, and maintaining it in a way that allows rapid expansion when needed, and contraction again when the need has passed. It means understanding that a capability is only militarily usable when it is sustainable, having adequate capacity to survive losses. As someone who was responsible for a root and branch reorganisation of the Territorial Army, formerly the British Army's reserve force, so as to keep it fit for purpose in a changing world, something for which many officers criticised him in his day, Hackett would have understood well that in the circumstances of the early 21st century, expansion must be possible for all forms of power, not just for kinetic force. An adaptable and effective strategic outlook must also meet two other requirements. The first is the need for a new understanding of reserves as crucial for all future operations, with new structures put in place to harness talent from all corners of civilian society. To fight hybrid war, it will be essential to combine and use new forms of influence, power, and coercion, integrating civilians, reserves, and regulars effectively, and to be able to dismantle and rebuild these power structures as many times as necessary, in whatever format is most appropriate to the challenge being faced. The second requirement is for a significant increase in intelligence capability and capacity to give maximum possible warning of new threats to counter or opportunities to exploit in the national or allied interest. In the 21st century, strategic intelligence must cover a much broader spectrum in order to deal with all elements of ambiguous warfare, while maintaining a close overwatch of both conventional and nuclear military capabilities. More so than in other sectors of the national strategic posture, intelligence organisations must be able to expand and contract quickly, assessing the expertise needed, expertise, capabilities and capacities that the military could never afford to maintain within a regular force structure. Old models of the intelligence process are no longer sufficient. Concentrating on finding the nuggets of secret intelligence that will provide a conclusive answer to a strategic problem is no longer likely to be possible, and most certainly will not be sufficient. Classified material must be supplemented by the ability to exploit the mass of open-source material available. This in turn may require the ability to identify, harness, and empower those on the ground who have the knowledge and skills to understand and navigate open-source material, distinguishing what is important and decisive from what is not. To organize this will require different structures, processes, and skills. In many circumstances, it will require deep cultural knowledge and the trust of those communities which are the focus of interest. Russia's strategic challenge. The extent to which Russia's strategic challenge to the West can be laid entirely at Putin's door can be debated. But there can be no doubt that in defining Russia as different from the West, as not needing the West, and as morally superior to the West, Putin has set Russia's course for the foreseeable future. His information and influence campaign has nowhere been more successful than in Russia itself. As evinced by the often vituperative rhetoric coming out of Moscow, Putin has let the genie out of the bottle. He has successfully made an enemy of the West in the eyes of many of his people, and in the eyes of virtually all of Russia's defense and security establishment, the so-called power ministries, army, interior troops, emergency troops, intelligence and security services. Their sense of affront and resentment of the West today is palpable. Any successor to Putin would find it difficult to change this quickly, even if he wanted to. The West is seen as hostile to Russia. Russia will be secure only when it controls its neighbors. Zero-sum gain has become the only measure of successful relations with the West. Putin's objectives are generally agreed by analysts to be twofold: to stay in power, which includes maintaining his wealth, and to retake lost ground, to restore Russia's position of influence and prestige in the world, lost with the disintegration of the USSR. For a West that has spent much of the last 25 years trying to include Russia, to make it a partner, to persuade Russia to become like us and embrace Western values, this is particularly difficult for Western leaders to acknowledge. It will be hard to undo the organizational changes that NATO made to bring Russia closer to the alliance to the extent that it did. And it will be even harder for governments to reverse the spending patterns that have been established for the past 25 years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.